Today, we're going to talk all about molar pregnancy. If you have been diagnosed with a molar pregnancy, you've had one in the past and you're still unsure about it, you have a friend that was diagnosed with it and you don't know what it is, it's a rare pregnancy complication. And today, you're going to learn all about exactly what a molar pregnancy is, how it's diagnosed, how it's treated, and some common questions that my patients have asked me. So let's get started. I'm Dr. Lora Shahine. I'm a double board certified OBGYN and reproductive endocrinologist, helping people build families and diagnose and treat molar pregnancy for over 20 years. And I love educating. If this is the first time that you found this channel, hit that subscribe button so you can make sure and get my weekly videos all about reproductive health. And if you're coming back to the channel, welcome back. I'm so happy to connect with you. There's two other ways to stay connected with me. Number one, sign up for my weekly newsletter where you get lots of information, educational content, and things that I recommend. And number two is my podcast. That's another thing that I put out here on the YouTube channel, but also anywhere you listen to podcasts, where weekly we can kind of do deep dives into topics, some interviews, and all things reproductive health. Now, today we are talking about a molar pregnancy. This article came out pretty recently in the Times, and it's titled, "At 30, My Pregnancy Gave Me Cancer." And that captured my attention. It captured a lot of people's attention that reached out to me, DMs on Instagram, comments on YouTube, questions on my website. A lot of people are like, wait a minute, how can a pregnancy give you cancer? And by the way, what is a molar pregnancy? Made me realize that I had not made an entire piece of content about molar pregnancy, and it might be rare, but when it happens to you, you want to understand exactly what's happening. So that is what we're doing today. We're going to go over five main topics. Topic number one, we're going to go over exactly what a molar pregnancy is. Topic number two, we'll go over how common it is or how rare it is. Topic number three, we'll go over some risk factors for molar pregnancy. Topic number four, diagnosis of molar pregnancy. And finally, topic number five, treatment for molar pregnancy. Now stick around to the end where I answer two common questions from my patients. Number one, how fast can we try and get pregnant after we've been treated for molar pregnancy? And number two, what is the deal with molar pregnancy causing cancer? And explain that more, please. So let's learn about molar pregnancy. Topic number one, what exactly is a molar pregnancy? It is a pregnancy. So egg and sperm come together and fertilize, but the way the genetics come together are abnormal. And this pregnancy, the way it's developed, develops in a certain way and comes from a certain way that the genetics come together. It is not viable. You can think of it as like a miscarriage, because that too is fertilization happens, implantation happens, but the pregnancy doesn't turn into a live birth or a baby. But it's a very specific type of miscarriage from genetic issues. Let me explain. So when the egg and sperm come together, they each give half of the genetic information, and that genetic code comes on chromosomes. Every cell in our body, we have 23 chromosomes, two pairs. One came from the egg that we came from, one came from the sperm that we came from. And in order to be here, we have to have balanced copies of these chromosomes. And when the egg and sperm come together, they either get it right or wrong. And so sometimes people have an extra chromosome or they'll miss a chromosome that can result in early miscarriage. It's actually the most common cause of miscarriage. Now, this process can happen and result in something called a molar pregnancy, which is a little bit different. There's two types of molar pregnancies depending on how the eggs and sperm fertilize: complete molar pregnancy and partial molar pregnancy. In a complete molar pregnancy, the egg is fertilized with either one or sometimes two sperm, but the egg chromosomes are not expressed. You're only getting expression from the male chromosomes that are from the sperm, either one or two sperm. The tissue that results is just swollen placental tissue. It, you know, this pregnancy implants and it grows, but it is not a viable pregnancy. It's a molar pregnancy, and it's coming from this in expression of the egg chromosomes. A partial molar pregnancy is when the egg chromosomes are there and working and expressed, but the egg gets fertilized with two sperm, and each of those sperm are expressing their chromosomes. And so there's actually 69 chromosomes in this tissue. Typically, it's 46, 23 from the egg, 23 from the sperm. In a partial molar pregnancy, it's 69 chromosomes. Now, there is some fetal tissue that's forming in a partial molar pregnancy, but it's mainly this overgrowth of abnormal placental tissue. And again, this is also not viable. It is not a healthy pregnancy that can continue. It's a type of miscarriage. It's just molar pregnancies, complete and partial. Both of these molar pregnancies are a part of a larger kind of class of abnormal pregnancy growth that's called gestational trophoblastic disease. Topic number two, how common is a molar pregnancy? It's actually rare. It only happens in 1 in 1,000 pregnancies. Topic number three, what are the risk factors for molar pregnancy? It can honestly happen to anyone, but there's four things that have been shown in the literature to put you at a slightly higher risk of molar pregnancy. Number one is age. Younger age and advanced reproductive age can be associated with molar pregnancy. Age less than 20 when you conceive, or age 35 or older. Number two risk factor, a history of a molar pregnancy. If it's happened before, there's a slightly higher chance it could happen again, although it's still very rare. Number three risk factor is where you live. It's actually more common in Southeast Asia than in other parts of the world. And number four, there is some association with some nutritional factors that could put you at higher risk of molar pregnancy, specifically being deficient in vitamin A. If any of those risk factors resonated with you, not telling you that to make you worry, it's still very unlikely that you would get a molar pregnancy. But some people are just curious. And when we're trying to figure out why things happen in medicine, we try to look at similarities. And these are the four risk factors that come up. Topic number four, how is a molar pregnancy diagnosed? It can be diagnosed with blood work, ultrasound, or on tissue pathology when you're looking at the pregnancy tissue under the microscope. As far as ultrasound, it can show up when you're getting early ultrasounds, like in the first trimester, maybe even later, and you're looking for very specific things that you would expect at a certain time in the gestation. Like at around, 8 weeks gestation, you would expect to see a gestational sac, a little crown rump like of a fetus, and even a little heartbeat. But in a molar pregnancy, you are not going to see that particular expected findings in your first trimester. It could just look like a bunch of cysts kind of in the uterine cavity, or an irregular looking findings on the ultrasound. If you're curious what typical first trimester pregnancy ultrasound findings look like, I actually have a whole YouTube video on this that can help people understand what to expect when they go in and get these first trimester ultrasounds, what things should look like. I've got lots of pictures, and I really hope that that is helpful. As far as blood work, diagnosing a molar pregnancy, it can really differ in everybody, and presentations are different. But significantly higher than expected HCG levels for where you are in your gestation can be a warning sign and might trigger further investigation. And finally, pathology. So if you have a DNC, the pathologist is looking at the pregnancy tissue under the microscope, they can see gestational trophoblastic disease, they can do genetic testing and chromosome testing on that tissue and see if it is a molar pregnancy, and if it is, diagnose either a complete or partial molar pregnancy based on the pregnancy tissue. You don't have to have a DNC to get this tested. Sometimes people will have a spontaneous loss and collect the tissue and give it to the lab or their clinic in order to get that testing done. But diagnosis is usually ultrasound, blood work, or pathology. As far as symptoms, sometimes people don't have any symptoms of molar pregnancy, but sometimes people have spotting, heavy bleeding in early pregnancy. Sometimes they'll feel that their belly is more swollen or their uterus feels like it's growing faster than they were expecting. And sometimes people have higher levels of nausea and vomiting, sometimes due to these elevated beta HCG levels. Not everyone who has these symptoms has a molar pregnancy, and not everyone who has a molar pregnancy will have these symptoms, but these are some things that have been seen. Topic number five, what is the treatment of molar pregnancy? A molar pregnancy is not a viable pregnancy, and it will not continue to be a baby, and it does need to be treated like a miscarriage. And so most of the time, people will have a DNC that will ensure that tissue is collected so someone can get the correct diagnosis. But there are rare cases where people have a spontaneous pregnancy and they find out later that it was a molar pregnancy because the tissue is tested. After resolution of the pregnancy, which is typically a DNC or evacuation of the uterine cavity, the doctor will follow the beta HCG levels to make sure it resolves and make sure that all of that abnormal tissue has been removed. There are rare cases where that tissue really implants and it continues to make the pregnancy hormone. And that is what that article with the 30-year-old saying, like, hey, my pregnancy gave me cancer. That is abnormal growth of that abnormal tissue that turns into abnormal cells and sometimes can require chemotherapy for treatment. I'll talk more about that in just a minute. But that is the reason that your doctor will follow the hormone levels to make sure everything is resolved. So that is the overview of molar pregnancy. I hope that it is a little bit more clear. I want to leave you with two common questions from my patients. Number one, how fast after resolution of a molar pregnancy can you get pregnant? And number two, what is this rare outcome of cancer after a pregnancy? So for when you can get pregnant, it really depends on a lot. You have to have complete resolution of the molar pregnancy, like really watch the beta HCG level go to zero. And your doctor will check it usually for another couple of months to make sure that it doesn't pop back up. A lot of times people are recommended to wait to try to get pregnant for at least 6 months, sometimes even a year, if there really is worrisome of abnormal gestational trophoblastic disease. I know that sounds extreme when you are ready to build your family, complete your family. I'm not saying everybody has to wait that long. It really depends on each person's situation, the diagnosis, whether it's partial, whether it is complete, how fast resolution came, and whether somebody does need further treatment. But in general, there is a recommendation to wait a little bit and talk to your doctor about what is right for your situation. Now, as far as molar pregnancies turning into cancer, this is so rare, but that one, you know, Times article just made people kind of aware of it. And it is important because it's so shocking if it happens to you, even if it's rare, just to kind of understand like, oh, okay, I'm not the only person that this has happened to you. So what's happening is this abnormal tissue, this gestational trophoblastic tissue has actually implanted and is not able to be removed from the body, or it continues to develop and change and turn into abnormal fast-growing cells. It's usually treated with chemotherapy, something like methotrexate, and it can usually be followed, you know, of course, as an outpatient and over time, really making sure that there's complete resolution and people are usually monitored with the beta HCG blood levels. There are rare cases where this abnormal tissue actually implants in different parts of the body, you know, in the lungs, sometimes in the brain. It can be like a metastatic disease, and this is called choriocarcinoma. Again, this is very rare. It is very treatable, and it is unlikely to happen to you, but I just think it's really, really important to understand how important it is to get a diagnosis of molar pregnancy and get proper treatment and proper follow-up. So today we learned all about molar pregnancy. We talked about exactly what it is. You learned about the genetics. You learned about how rare it is, how it's diagnosed, how it's treated, and then kind of the common questions like when can you try again? And what about this rare complication of choriocarcinoma or abnormal cells from a molar pregnancy? Listen, a molar pregnancy is not your fault. A lot of people are, you know, they kind of feel like the medical team is so focused on resolution of the pregnancy, making sure it's not cancer, monitoring closely, that we forget that this was a serious loss, especially if it was a highly desired pregnancy. And the waiting or the follow-up or the medical care when all you wanted to do was have a baby can be extremely trying and a lot of emotions. It is grief. It's lost time. People can get medical bills from this, and all you wanted was to have a baby. And so pay attention to your mental health through this process. Pay attention to your emotional well-being. Get support as you're going through this. Share this video with loved ones who don't understand what a molar pregnancy is and kind of what it means for long-term follow-up and the emotional part of it. Your job is to not have to educate other people that are trying to give you support, but your friends and family and loved ones might not have ever heard of molar pregnancy. So if this could be a video that you share with those people to kind of help ease the burden of you having to explain everything over and over again, then I'm so glad that you found this. And I just really, truly, anybody that's out there feeling shame or vulnerable or worried that they did anything to cause a molar pregnancy is absolutely not true. So I really hope this is helpful. Like this video if you learned something. Comment with any questions that you have. Be sure and subscribe to this channel so you get my weekly videos all about reproductive health. You can find my podcast in the playlist here. That comes out once a week as well. And until next week, wishing you love, luck, and pineapples.